This is Inter-Surface Maps via Constant-Curvature Metrics, as presented at SIGGRAPH 2020, by Patrick Schmidt, Marcel Campen, Janis and Leif Kobbelt. Our goal in this work is to compute high-quality maps between pairs of surfaces, such that every point on one surface is mapped to a corresponding point on the other surface. A classical application scenario is transferring surface attributes. Given such a map, we can, for example, transfer a texture by mapping UV coordinates. In the same way, we can also map geometric detail, like a displacement map, or a surface deformation, or a surface tessellation from one model to another, or almost any other information defined on the surface. Intersurface maps can also be a building block in more complex shape processing pipelines. Think of processing large shape collections, where we often need to map many meshes to a common base domain, or having to analyze time-varying data for which correspondence between frames is not given. We might need to interpolate intermediate frames, to transport data across the entire sequence, or to perform compatible remeshing. There are many different application scenarios, and especially when other algorithms build upon our mapping, even small defects in the map can very easily break these applications. We can rule out such problems from the beginning when we can guarantee that our map fulfills a number of properties. First of all, it is important that the map is continuous, that is, without sudden jumps, because these could tear the transferred data apart and invalidate it. We also need the map to be bijective, meaning that it does not contain any foldovers and that it covers both meshes entirely, so that we have a full one-to-one correspondence. We also want it to have low mapping distortion, so that it stretches only as much as it needs to and only where it needs to. The first two criteria are binary, they're either fulfilled or not, and the class of maps that fulfills them is called surface homeomorphisms. To enable reliable processing pipelines, we're interested in this class of maps specifically. Many existing methods use relaxed variants of this definition, which are simpler to represent or easier to optimize. For example, non-rigid registration or projection-based methods use an extrinsic approach, where a source mesh is deformed in 3D ambient space to match the target. Functional maps switch to a spectral representation and then usually recover a map that is only defined at the vertices and without bijectivity guarantees. Other approaches do produce surface homeomorphisms by construction, usually by mapping via a continuous intermediate domain. However, direct distortion control is more difficult in this setting, and last year we presented a method that does optimize mapping distortion via the plane, but it is restricted to disk topology surfaces. In this paper, we present a new map representation for discrete surface homeomorphisms. So our maps are guaranteed to be continuous and bijective. They are defined at every surface point in a continuous sense, not just at the vertices. They can be optimized for low distortion using continuous global optimization. And our representation supports general topology, meaning that it works for closed surfaces of any genus. To understand why finding a good representation of intersurface maps is difficult, let's start by looking at maps to the plane again. We can represent such a map simply by specifying the images of vertices in the plane. If we choose a piecewise linear map, the images of edges and triangles follow from that implicitly by linear interpolation. When mapping to a discrete surface, however, such an implicit definition is not as obvious. So let's again explicitly map the vertex images, this time via barycentric coordinates in a target triangle. A natural way to map edges is as piecewise linear curves on the target surface. But there are a lot of different paths this curve could take, and explicitly representing the path in an optimization problem, with all these intersection points as variables, will cause combinatorial challenges and is very difficult to optimize. We would rather like to use all the advantages from the planar setting, in which the edge images are defined implicitly. One possible choice would be to define them as shortest geodesics, but unfortunately, geodesics on a discrete surface are not unique. So we don't know which version of this path we actually mean. Another problem is that geodesics are not continuously varying with respect to their endpoints. So if I move this vertex continuously, the shortest path can suddenly jump, which is a huge problem for optimization. So the biggest task really is to find a good definition for edge images, that is implicit, unique, and continuously varying. Because if we have such a definition, we can again just use the vertex images as variables and perform continuous optimization on them. The remaining task is then to decide on a parameterization inside triangles. And it would be nice to have one that is piecewise linear. We'll later see that once we've solved the first task, this second task will not be too difficult. So let's focus on how to map edges. The idea of using shortest geodesics here would be perfect if it wasn't for these uniqueness and continuity problems. What a geodesic looks like on a surface is determined by the surface's metric. At each point, it tells us how expensive it is to walk into a certain direction. On a triangle mesh, we can also view it as the intrinsic shape of each triangle, and we can represent it, for example, by storing a length for each edge. Now we can think of assigning virtual edge length to our mesh, and this will change how geodesics behave. Earlier I mentioned the benefits of mapping to the plane. Geodesics in the plane are just straight lines, so we could map our target surface to the plane and compute geodesics there. And this really is the same as equipping the surface with a flat metric. We assign edge length such that the discrete curvature at each vertex becomes zero. We then know that geodesics in this metric will be unique, because they are just straight line segments in the plane. And in retrospect, this is what many methods that map via the plane exploit implicitly. So is our problem solved? Not really, because this is not going to work in a globally consistent way. Assigning a flat metric to a closed surface is not possible in general. And we know this because of the Gauss-Bonnet Theorem, which relates the total Gaussian curvature to the genus of an object. Only for genus 1, this curvature integral is 0, so that we can actually use a flat metric. For genus 0, this integral is positive, and for genus 2 and higher, it will always be negative. For those cases, we want to generalize the idea of no curvature everywhere, and we do this by choosing constant curvature everywhere instead. A metric with constant positive curvature is a spherical metric, so we can think of all these edge lengths that we assign as the length of arcs on the unit sphere. Metrics with constant negative curvature are called hyperbolic metrics, so here edge length corresponds to length in the hyperbolic plane. How can we represent the hyperbolic plane? Both the sphere and the flat plane can be embedded in Euclidean space without distortion, but the hyperbolic plane cannot. Think of it as being saddle-shaped at every point, and this is something that we cannot realize in Euclidean space. Instead, there are a number of models of the hyperbolic plane, like the Poincaré disk, the Klein model, or the hyperboloid model, and each of these is distorted in a different way. In our case, we're only going to use the last one, in which the hyperbolic plane is mapped to the surface of this bowl-shaped hyperboloid, and we cut it open to see the inside. Edge length in this model will appear distorted, but we have a formula to compute their undistorted length. Now, how do we compute geodesics on a surface with respect to a constant curvature metric? We could solve some PDE on the discrete surface, or, and this is the key benefit of having these three model manifolds, we can use very simple constructions directly on the sphere, the plane, and the hyperboloid. A geodesic on the sphere is the intersection of a plane through the origin with that sphere. We chose the hyperboloid model because the exact same construction works here too. Geodesics are intersections of the hyperboloid with a plane through the origin. And for the flat case, well, we know how to compute geodesics in the plane, but for the sake of unifying all three settings, let's move the xy plane up to height 1 and then apply the same construction of intersecting it with another plane. We will also need to compute the intersection point of two geodesic line segments, and we can do this by intersecting both of their defining planes with the model manifold. So the nice thing here is that we can use the same formulas in all three cases. And one detail that I'm skipping here is that we still need to choose a parameterization of these curves, so that we are later able to store the parameters of the intersection. In the paper, we show a simple construction that achieves this via central projections. Let's go back to our task of representing edge images on a target surface. Assuming that we have equipped the surface with a constant curvature metric, we can now take the relevant part of the mesh and embed it on the respective model manifold. That means we temporarily come up with vertex positions from known spherical, flat, or hyperbolic edge length. And it doesn't matter where on the model manifold we do that, because it is shaped the same way everywhere. We now add our vertices via their barycentric coordinates, we connect them via geodesics, and we compute all those intersection points with the target edges. Finally, we take these intersection points back to the original target mesh. And here we have our implicitly defined edge images. If I now move a vertex continuously, the incident edge images will follow continuously too. But are these edge images really unique? Here is a Genus 1 object equipped with a flat metric. There are still multiple shortest geodesics under that metric, each in a different homotopy class. And to understand these homotopy classes better, we can look at the surface in the plane, where each edge of the target mesh actually has the correct length that was assigned to it by the metric. And this is called a universal cover. It repeats infinitely in all directions and covers the entire plane. So each point on the surface has multiple instances in the plane. And connecting different instances by geodesics corresponds to paths in different homotopy classes on the surface. So when connecting two mapped vertices, we have infinitely many classes to choose from. And to make sure that we're always referring to the correct one, we explicitly store the homotopy class of each edge that we map. And we can do that by keeping track of a triangle strip between the two vertices, which is in the desired homotopy class. And with that, we now finally managed to uniquely describe this path. Let's summarize the map representation we've developed so far. We explicitly map source vertices to barycentric coordinates in target triangles. We map source edges to homotopy classes via representative triangle strips. And we give target edges a spherical, flat, or hyperbolic length, forming a constant curvature metric. We've seen that this map representation uniquely defines the images of vertices and edges on the target mesh. To extend the map inside triangles, I will now introduce a map completion operator. It takes such a map representation and computes an explicit piecewise linear map. As the representation already fully defines the map, this operator does not have any parameters. Also note that our representation is directed. It is from a source to a target surface. However, the dense correspondence defined by our map is symmetric. And in the paper, we describe another operator that switches this representation direction while still describing the same completed map. Now, what the completion operator does is it computes an overlay tessellation based on the vertices of both meshes as well as these intersection points. This tessellation exists on both the source and the target mesh, where it has the same connectivity. It contains 3, 4, 5, or 6 gons, which are always planar and convex. If we look at the two instances of one such polygon, we already know the map along the boundary. We now have to bijectively extend the map into the interior, and for simple evaluation and optimization, we opt for a piecewise linear extension here by simply triangulating the polygon. Applying the map completion operator on the entire mesh now gives us our piecewise linear map via a common tessellation of both models. And this common tessellation has a lot of benefits. Map evaluation is very easy, and it allows us to transfer a wide range of data. For example, textures with seams, because the seam edges of the source mesh are now also present on the target mesh. And this is something that many other methods cannot do. On the downside, the number of elements in our tessellation is larger than in the input models, and triangles can be badly shaped. But depending on the use case, we could coarsen the mesh again while still preserving bijectivity. Let me very briefly talk about how we use all these constructions in our actual algorithm. We start with an initial map representation without flipped or degenerate triangles. This can be obtained, for example, by connecting a few landmark correspondences via compatible path networks. After applying our map completion operator, we evaluate an intrinsic distortion measure like the symmetric Dirichlet energy. We can then compute derivatives with respect to the barycentric coordinates of the source vertices on the target surface. We use automatic differentiation and perform a Newton-style optimization borrowed from our previous paper. Every time we need to evaluate the objective function at a new point in solution space, we have to apply the map completion operator. Besides optimizing mapped vertices only, the shape of edge images can also be improved by including the underlying metric in the optimization. And luckily, this is possible without making it any more complicated by simply alternating the direction in which we represent our map. Because changing the mapped vertex positions in one direction implicitly changes the metric of the reverse direction, and also the other way around. We elaborate a lot more on this in the paper. This is a very distorted initial map, and we show the symmetric Dirichlet energy as a heat map. Here's a time lapse of the optimization sequence, where we see how the algorithm manages to remove as much distortion as possible. In our experiments, we compared the results of hyperbolic orbifold TUT embeddings, reversible harmonic maps, and our method. In this example, which is constrained by many landmarks, all three methods perform quite well. We now repeat the experiment, but remove one landmark at the wingtip. HOT produces a continuous bijection, by construction, but doesn't directly optimize mapping distortion. The resulting map is smooth, but with high distortion, since the algorithm has no incentive to correctly align the corresponding wings. RHM optimizes distortion, but works extrinsically, so that it cannot guarantee a bijective map when projecting to the surface. When RHM is not nicely constrained, as in this case, it can sometimes happen that it doesn't find a good optimum, causing severe distortion. Our algorithm always produces a continuous bijection, and in this case also manages to find the desired optimum. Here is another example with no landmarks on the head of the horse. This time RHM does achieve correct alignment, but still produces small regions with high distortion, which are not present in our result. This also shows quantitatively when we plot the percentage of surface area that is below a certain distortion threshold. So we want this curve to be in the upper left corner as far as possible. Between more non-isometric shapes, we observe that both other algorithms tend to concentrate distortion in some areas, while our method distributes the inevitable distortion more evenly, leading to a low maximum distortion value. The same observations also carry over to objects of higher genus. On this genus 5 mesh, we used a few landmarks for initialization only, and then released them during optimization. This is something that's not possible with HOT. In this example, we used a few more landmarks, allowing for artistic choices that overrule the goal of minimum distortion. For example, to keep the eyebrows in place. Here we start with an initialization far away from the desired map. While our algorithm usually reaches the desired solution, it is of course not immune to converging to a bad local optimum, as in this example where the fingers end up mismatched. So finding good optima automatically is an interesting direction for future work. Most constructions in our algorithm boil down to quite simple formulas with closed form solutions. But for example, embedding a mesh region on one of the model manifolds is currently performed incrementally, and guaranteeing consistency despite numerical inaccuracies here is also an interesting problem for future work. And lastly, we were able to adapt an optimization algorithm from the flat to the general topology setting. But it might take many iterations. In this example, with 12,000 input triangles, it took 600 iterations, which is about 25 minutes in our prototype implementation. So both taking larger steps in each iteration, as well as reducing the per iteration cost, will be of practical interest in the future. If you're interested in our work, feel free to check out our project page, and don't hesitate to reach out if you have any questions. Thank you for your attention. This was Intersurface Maps via Constant-Curvature Metrics by Patrick Schmidt, Marcel Campen, Janis and Leif Kobbelt.